Hey, I'm Rashonda Cade. This is Reading with Rashonda. We're going to read Clotel, or The President's Daughter is the subtitle, by William Wells Brown. It was originally published in 1853. So it's really important to know something about the author of a work before you read it. And in this particular instance, William Wells Brown was an escaped slave, and he included his memoir at the beginning of this book. So before we dive into the novel Clotel, we're going to read Narrative of the Life and Escape of William Wells Brown. It begins with a poem by Whittier. Shall tongues be mute when deeds are wrought, which well might shame extremists tell? Shall freemen lack the indignant thought? Shall mercy's bosom cease to swell? Shall honor bleed? Shall truth succumb? Shall pen and press and soul be dumb? William Wells Brown, the subject of this narrative, was born a slave in Lexington, Kentucky, not far from the residence of the late Honorable Henry Clay. His mother was the slave of Dr. John Young. His father was a slaveholder, and besides being a near relation of his master, was connected with the Wickliffe family, one of the oldest, wealthiest, and most aristocratic of the Kentucky planters. Dr. Young was the owner of 40 or 50 slaves, whose chief employment was in cultivating tobacco, hemp, corn, and flax. The doctor removed from Lexington when William was 5 or 6 years old to the state of Missouri and commenced farming in a beautiful and fertile valley within a mile of the Missouri River. Here the slaves were put to work under a harsh and cruel overseer named Cook. A finer situation for a farm could not have been selected in the state. With climate favorable to agriculture and soil rich, the products came in abundance. At an early age, William was separated from his mother, she being worked in the field, and he is a servant in his master's medical department. That's interesting, in a medical department. When about 10 years of age, the young slave's feelings were much hurt at hearing the cries of his mother while being flogged by the Negro driver for being a few minutes behind the other hands in reaching the field. He heard her cry, "Oh, pray! Oh, pray! Oh, pray!" These are the words which slaves generally utter when imploring mercy at the hands of their oppressors. The son heard it, though he was some way off. He heard the crack of the whip and the groans of his poor mother. The cold chill ran over him and he wept aloud. But he was a slave like his mother and could render no assistance. He was taught by the most bitter experience that nothing could be more heart-rending than to see a dear and beloved mother or sister tortured by unfeeling men, and to hear her cries and not be able to render the least aid. Particularly if you're working in your master's medical department. When William was 12 years of age, his master left his farm and took up his residence near St. Louis. The doctor having more hands than he wanted for his own use, William was let out to a Mr. Freeland, an innkeeper. Here the young slave found himself in the hands of a most cruel and heartless master. Freeland was one of the real chivalry of the South. Besides being himself a slaveholder, he was a horse racer, cockfighter, gambler, and to crown the whole, an inveterate drunkard. What else but bad treatment could be expected from such a character? After enduring the tyrannical and inhuman usage of this man for 5 or 6 months, William resolved to stand it no longer and therefore ran away, like other slaves who leave their masters owing to severe treatment. And not knowing where to flee, the young fugitive went into the forest a few miles from St. Louis. He had been in the woods but a short time when he heard the barking and howling of dogs and was soon satisfied that he was pursued by the Negro dogs, and aware of their ferocious nature, the fugitive climbed a tree to save himself from being torn to pieces. The hounds were soon at the trunk of the tree and remained there howling and barking until those in whose charge they were came up. The slave was ordered down, tied, and taken home. Immediately on his arrival there, he was, as he expected, tied up in the smokehouse and whipped till Freeland was satisfied and then smoked with tobacco stems. This the slaveholder called Virginia Play. After being well whipped and smoked, he was again set to work. William remained with this monster a few months longer and was then let out to Elijah P. Lovejoy, who years after became the editor of an abolition newspaper and was murdered at Alton, Illinois by a mob of slaveholders from the adjoining state of Missouri. The system of letting out slaves is one among the worst of the evils of slavery. The man who hires a slave looks upon him in the same light as does the man who hires a horse for a limited period. He feels no interest in him, only to get the worth of his money. Not so with the man who owns the slave. He regards him as so much property of which care should be taken. After being let out to a steamer as an understeward, William was hired by James Walker, a slave trader. Here, the subject of our memoir was made superintendent of the gang of slaves that were taken to the New Orleans market. In this capacity, William had opportunities far greater than most slaves of acquiring knowledge of the different phases of the peculiar institution. Walker was a Negro speculator who was amassing a fortune by trading in the bones, bloods, and nerves of God's children. The thoughts of such a traffic causes us to exclaim with the poet, "Is there not some chosen curse, some hidden thunder in the stores of heaven, red with uncommon wrath, to blast the man who gains his fortune from the blood of souls?" So a couple things. He was a steward on a ship that went to New Orleans, which is going south for slaves. Getting sold down south was one of the worst things that could happen. And I bet he did get to see a lot of facets of the peculiar institution of slavery. Between 50 and 60 slaves were chained together, put on board a steamboat bound for New Orleans, and started on the voyage. New and strange scenes began to inspire the young slave with the hope of escaping to a land of freedom. There was in the boat a large room on the lower deck on which the slaves were kept, men and women promiscuously, all chained two and two together, not even leaving the poor slaves the privilege of choosing their partners. A strict watch was kept over them, so that they had no chance of escape. Cases had occurred in which slaves had got off their chains and made their escape at the landing places while the boat stopped to take in wood. But with all their care, they lost one woman who had been taken from her husband and children, and having no desire to live without them, in the agony of her soul, jumped overboard and drowned herself. Her sorrows were greater than she could bear. Slavery and its cruel inflictions had broken her heart. She, like William, sighed for freedom, but not the freedom which even British soil confers and inspires, but freedom from torturing pangs and overwhelming grief. At the end of the week, they arrived in New Orleans, the place of their destination. Here, the slaves were placed in a Negro pen where those who wished to purchase could call and examine them. The Negro pen is a small yard surrounded by buildings from 15 to 20 feet wide, with the exception of a large gate with iron bars. The slaves are kept in the buildings during the night and turned into the pen during the day. After the best of the gang were sold off, the balance was taken to the exchange coffee house auction rooms and sold at public auction. After the sale of the last slave, William and Mr. Walker left New Orleans for St. Louis. And that New Orleans to St. Louis route was a pretty popular one. That's straight up and down the Mississippi. After they had been at St. Louis a few weeks, another cargo of human flesh was made up. There were amongst the lot several old men and women, some of whom had gray locks. On their way down to New Orleans, William had prepared the old slaves for a market. He was ordered to shave off the old men's whiskers and to pluck out the gray hairs where they were not too numerous. Where they were, he colored them with a preparation of blacking with a blacking brush. After having gone through the blacking process, they looked 10 or 15 years younger. William, though not well skilled in the use of scissors and razor, performed the office of the barber tolerably. After the sale of this gang of Negroes, they returned to St. Louis, and a second cargo was made up. In this lot was a woman who had a child at the breast, yet was compelled to travel through the interior of the country on foot with the other slaves. In a published memoir of his life, William says, "The child cried during the most of the day, which displeased Mr. Walker, and he told the mother that if her child did not stop crying, he would stop its mouth." After a long and weary journey under a burning sun, we put up for the night at a country inn. The following morning, just as they were about to start, the child again commenced crying. Walker stepped up to her and told her to give the child to him. The mother tremblingly obeyed. He took the child by one arm as anyone would a cat by the leg, and walked into the house where they had been staying, and he said to the lady, "Madam, I will make you a present of this little nigger. It keeps making such a noise that I can't bear it." "Thank you, sir," said the lady. The mother, as soon as she saw that her child was to be left, ran up to Mr. Walker and, falling on her knees, begged of him in an agony of despair to let her have her child. She clung round his legs so closely that for some time he could not kick her off, and she cried, "Oh, my child, master, do let me have my dear, dear child. Oh, do, do. I will stop its crying and love you forever if only you will let me have my child again." But her prayers were not heeded. They passed on, and the mother was separated from her child forever. After the woman's child had been given away, Mr. Walker rudely commanded her to retire into the ranks with the other slaves. Women who had children were not chained, but those who had none were. As soon as her child was taken, she was chained to the gang. Sometime after this, Walker bought a woman who had a blind child. It being considered worthless, it was given to the trader by the former owner of the woman on the score of humanity, he saying that he wished to keep mother and child together. At first, Walker declined taking the child, saying it would be too much trouble, but the mother, wishing to have her boy with her, begged him to take it, promising to carry it the whole distance in her arms. Consequently, he took the child, and the gang started on their route to the nearest steamboat landing, which was above 100 miles. As might have been expected, the woman was unable to carry the boy and keep up with the rest of the gang. They put up at night at a small town, and the next morning, when about to start, Walker took the little boy from its mother and sold it to the innkeeper for the small sum of $1. The poor woman was so frantic at the idea of being separated from her only child that it seemed impossible to get her to leave it. Not until the chains were put upon her limbs and she fastened to the other slaves could they get her to leave the spot. By main force, this slave mother was compelled to go on and leave her child behind. Some days after, a lady from one of the free states was traveling the same road and put up at the same inn. She saw the child the morning after her arrival and heard its history from one of the slaves, which was confirmed by the innkeeper's wife. A few days after, the following poem appeared in one of the newspapers from the pen of the lady who had seen the blind child. "Come back to me, mother, why linger away from thy poor little blind boy the long weary day? I mark every footstep, I list to each tone, and wonder my mother should leave me alone. There are voices of sorrow and voices of glee, but there's no one to joy or to sorrow for me. For each hath of pleasure and trouble his share, and none of the poor little blind boy will care. My mother, come back to me, close to thy breast. Once more let thy poor little blind one be pressed. Once more let me feel thy warm breath on my cheek, and hear thee in accents of tenderness speak. Oh, mother, I've no one to love me. No heart can bear like thy own in my sorrows apart. No hand is so gentle, no voice is so kind. Oh, none like a mother can cherish the blind. Poor blind one, no mother thy wailing can hear. No mother can hasten to banish thy fear. For the slave owner drives her o'er mountain and wild, and for one paltry dollar hath sold thee, poor child. Ah, who can in language of mortals reveal the anguish that none but a mother can feel? When man in his vile lust of mammon hath trod on her child who is stricken, and smitten of God, blind, helpless, forsaken, with strangers alone, she hears in his anguish his piteous moan, as he eagerly listens, but listens in vain, to catch the loved tones of his mother again. The curse of the broken in spirit shall fall on the wretch who hath mingled his wormwood and gall, and his gain like a mildew shall blight and destroy, who hath turned from his mother the little blind boy. The thought that man can so debase himself as to treat a fellow creature as here represented is enough to cause one to blush at the idea that such men are members of a civilized and Christian nation. I'm going to pause here for a moment because as we're going through William Wells Brown's autobiography, so far he's told us so much about other people and not so much about himself. But that's something to really think about. If someone is telling his own story in terms of other people, then there's something about those other people that we should really be paying attention to and thinking about how those other people have impacted his story. And we also have to remember that William Wells Brown is a writer, and not just a writer, a fiction writer. So he uses narrative in some very particular ways. So let's keep paying attention to how he is telling his story through others and how the stories of these others may come to bear in the novel Clotel that we'll read when we're finished reading his autobiography. So we've talked about mothers being separated from children. We've talked about some of the cruelty of slavery. Let's see what's next. Nothing was more grievous to the sensitive feelings of William than seeing the separation of families by the slave trader. Let's read that again. That sounds important. Nothing was more grievous to the sensitive feelings of William than seeing the separation of families by the slave trader. Husbands taken from their wives and mothers from their children without the least appearance of feeling on the part of those who separated them. While at New Orleans on one occasion, William saw a slave murdered. The circumstances were as follows. In the evening, between 7 and 8 o'clock, a slave came running down from the levee, followed by several men and boys. The whites were crying out, "Stop that nigger! Stop that nigger!" while the poor panting slave in almost breathless accents was repeating, "I did not steal the meat! I did not steal the meat!" The poor man at last took refuge in the river. The whites who were in pursuit of him ran on board of one of the boats to see if they could discover him. They finally espied him under the bow of the steamboat Trenton. They got a pike pole and tried to drive him from his hiding place. When they struck at him, he would dive under the water. The water was so cold that it soon became evident that he must come out or be drowned. While they were trying to drive him from under the boat or drown him, he in broken and imploring accents said, "I did not steal the meat. I did not steal the meat. My master lives up the river. I want to see my master. I did not steal the meat. Do let me go home to my master." After punching and striking him over the head for some time, he at last sunk in the water to rise no more alive. On the end of the pike pole with which they had been striking him was a hook which caught in his clothing, and they hauled him up on the bow of the boat. Some said he was dead, others said he was playing possum, while others kicked him to make him get up, but it was of no use. He was dead. As soon as they became satisfied on this, they commenced leaving one after another. One of the hands on the boat informed the captain that they had killed the man and the dead body was lying on the deck. The captain, whose name was Hart, came on deck and said to those who were remaining, "You have killed this nigger, now take him off my boat." The dead body was dragged on shore and left there. William went on board of the boat where the gang of slaves were, and during the whole night his mind was occupied with what he had seen. Early in the morning he went on shore to see if the dead body remained there. He found it in the same position that it was left the night before. He watched to see what they would do with it. It was left there until between 8 and 9 o'clock when a cart which took up from the trash from the streets came along and the body was thrown in. And a few minutes more was covered over with dirt, which they were removing from the streets. At the expiration of the period of his hiring with Walker, William returned to his master, rejoiced to have escaped an employment as much against his own feelings as it was repugnant to human nature. But this joy was of short duration. The doctor wanted money and resolved to sell William's sister and two brothers. The mother had been previously sold to a gentleman residing in the city of St. Louis. William's master now informed him that he intended to sell him, and as he was his own nephew, he gave him the privilege of finding someone to purchase him. Let's read that again. William's master now informed him that he intended to sell him, and as he was his own nephew, he gave him the privilege of finding someone to purchase him. William was his white master's nephew, which leads me to believe that William's father was the white brother of his current white master. Let's let that sink in. All right, one more time. William's master was now informed that he was intended to sell him, and as he was his own nephew, he gave him the privilege of finding someone to purchase him who would treat him better than if he was sold on the auction block. William tried to make some arrangement by which he could purchase his own freedom, but the old doctor would hear nothing of the kind. If there is one thing more revolting in the trade of human flesh than another, it is the selling of one's own blood relations. And let me tell you, it happened a lot. He accordingly set out for the city in search of a new master. When he arrived there, he proceeded to the gaol. I've never really known how to pronounce that word. I know it's a prison. Not really sure how to say it. He proceeded to the Gael with the hope of seeing his sister, but was again disappointed. On the following morning, he made another attempt, and was allowed to see her once for the last time. When he entered the room where she was seated in one corner, alone and disconsolate, there were four other women in the room belonging to the same man who were brought, the gaoler said, for the master's own use. So William Wells Brown's sister was in this holding cell with four other women who all belonged to the same man who were bought for the master's own use. It doesn't say here explicitly that the master's own use was sexual, but that's most likely what it was. William's sister was seated with her face towards the door when he entered, but her gaze was transfixed on nothingness, and she did not look up when he walked up to her. But as soon as she observed him, she sprang up, threw her arms around his neck, leaned her head upon his breast, and without uttering a word, in silent, indescribable sorrow, burst into tears. She remained so for some minutes, but when she recovered herself sufficiently to speak, she urged him to take his mother immediately and to try to get to the land of freedom. She said there was no hope for herself. She must live and die a slave. After giving her some advice and taking a ring from his finger, he bade her farewell forever. Reader, did ever a fair sister of thine go down to the grave prematurely? If so, perchance, thou hast drank deeply from the cup of sorrow. But how infinitely better is it for a sister to go into the silent land with her honor untarnished, but with bright hopes, than for her to be sold to sensual slaveholders. William had been in the city now 2 days, and as he was to be absent for only a week, it was well that he should make the best use of his time if he intended to escape. In conversing with his mother, he found her unwilling to make the attempt to reach the land of liberty, but she advised him by all means to get there himself if he possibly could. She said, as all her children were in slavery, she did not wish to leave them, but he loved his mother so intensely that he could not think of leaving without her. He consequently used all his simple eloquence to induce her to fly with him, and at last he prevailed. They consequently fixed upon the next night as the time for their departure. The time at length arrived, and they left the city just as the clock struck 9. Having found a boat, they crossed the river in it. Whose boat it was, he did not know, neither did he care. When it had served his purpose, he turned it adrift, and when he saw it last, it was going at a good speed down the river. After walking in the main road as fast as they could all night, when the morning came, they made for the woods and remained there during the day. But when night came again, they proceeded on their journey with nothing but the North Star to guide them. They continued to travel by night and to bury themselves in the silent solitudes of the forest by day. Hunger and fatigue could not stop them, for the prospect of freedom at the end of the journey nerved them up. The very thought of leaving slavery with its democratic whips, Republican chains, and bloodhounds caused the hearts of the weary fugitives to leap with joy. After traveling 10 nights and hiding in the woods during the day for fear of being arrested and taken back, they thought they might with safety go the rest of their way by daylight. In nearly all the free states, there were men who make a business of catching runaway slaves and returning them to their owners for the reward that may be offered. Some of these were on the alert for William and his mother, for they had already seen their runaways advertised in the St. Louis newspapers. All at once they heard a click of a horse's hoof, and looking back saw 3 men on horseback galloping towards them. They soon came up and demanded them to stop. The 3 men dismounted, arrested them on a warrant, and showed them a handbill offering $200 for their apprehension and delivery to Dr. Young and Isaac Mansfield in St. Louis. While they were reading the handbill, William's mother looked him in the face and burst into tears. "A cold chill ran over me," says he, "and such a sensation I never experienced before, and I trust I never shall again." They took out a rope and tied him, and they were taken back to the house of the individual who appeared to be the leader. They then had something given them to eat and were separated. Each of them was watched over by 2 men during the night. The religious characteristic of the American slaveholder soon manifested itself, as before the family retired to rest, they were all called together to attend prayers, and the very man who, but a few hours before, had arrested poor, panting fugitive slaves, now read a chapter from the Bible and offered a prayer to God, as if that benign and omnipotent one consecrated the infernal act he had just committed. The next morning, they were chained and handcuffed and started back to St. Louis. A journey of 3 days brought the fugitives again to the place they had left 12 days previously with the hope that they would never return. They were put in prison to await the orders of their owners. When a slave attempts to escape and fails, he feels sure of either being severely punished or sold to the Negro traders and taken to the far south, there to be worked up on a cotton, sugar, or rice plantation. This William and his mother dreaded. While they were in suspense as to what would be their fate, news came to them that the mother had been sold to a slave speculator. William was soon sold to a merchant residing in the city and removed to his new owner's dwelling. In a few days, the gang of slaves, of which William's mother was one, were taken on board a steamer to be carried to the New Orleans market. The young slave obtained permission from his new owner to go and take a last farewell of his mother. He went to the boat and found her there, chained to another woman, and the whole number of slaves, amounting to some 50 or 60, chained in the same manner. As the son approached his mother, she moved not, neither did she weep. Her emotions were too deep for tears. William approached her, threw his arms around her neck, kissed her, fell upon his knees, begging her forgiveness, for he thought he was to blame for her sad condition, and if he had not persuaded her to accompany him, she might not have been in chains then. She remained for some time, apparently unimpressionable, tearless, sighless, but in the innermost depths of her heart moved mighty passions. William says she finally raised her head, looked me in the face, and such a look none but an angel can give, and said, "My dear son, you are not to blame for my being here. You have done nothing more nor less than your duty. Do not, I pray you, weep for me. I cannot last long upon a cotton plantation. I feel that my heavenly master will soon call me home, and then I shall be out of the hands of the slaveholders." I could hear no more. My heart struggled to free itself from the human form. In a moment, she was Mr. Mansfield, her master coming toward that part of the boat, and she whispered in my ear, "My child, we must soon part to meet no more on this side of the grave. You have ever said that you would not die a slave, that you would be a free man. Now try to get your liberty. You will soon have no one to look after but yourself." And just as she whispered the last sentence into my ear, Mansfield came up to me and with an oath said, "Leave here this instant. You have been the means of my losing $100 to get this wench back," at the same time kicking me with a heavy pair of boots. As I left her, she gave one shriek, saying, "God be with you." It was the last time that I saw her, and the last word I heard her utter. I walked on shore. The bell was tolling. The boat was about to start. I stood with a heavy heart, waiting to see her leave the wharf. As I thought of my mother, I could but feel that I had lost the glory of my life, my blessing, and my pride. I half forgot the name of slave when she was by my side. The love of liberty that had been burning in my bosom had well nigh gone out. I felt as though I was ready to die. The boat moved gently from the wharf, and while she glided down the river, I realized that my mother was indeed gone, sold and gone, to the rice swamp, dark and lone. After the boat was out of sight, I returned home, but any thoughts were so absorbed in what I had witnessed that I knew not what I was about. Night came, but it brought no sleep to my eyes. When once the love of freedom is born in the slave's mind, it always increases and brightens, and William, having heard so much about Canada, where a number of his acquaintances had found a refuge and a home, he heartily desired to join them. Building castles in the air in the daytime, incessantly thinking of freedom, he would dream of the land of liberty, but on waking in the morning would weep to find it but a dream. He would dream of Victoria's domain, and in a moment he seemed to be there, but the fear of being taken again soon hurried him back to despair. So we'll stop there for now and pick up here next time. Thanks for listening. I'm Rashonda Cade, and this is Reading with Rashonda.